ओके। सो यू नो एज संभाजी वॉज गोइंग आउट ऑफ ट्रैक, शिवाजी वॉन्टेड टू ब्रिंग हिम ऑन द राइट ट्रैक, एंड इट इज अ रिलीजन स्पिरिचुअलिटी विच हेल्प्स द पीपल टू रिमेन ऑन द राइट ट्रैक, एंड ही केप्ट संभाजी एट सज्जनगढ़। सज्जनगढ़ वॉज अ प्लेस फोर्ट वेयर रामदास स्वामी यूज टू स्टे, एंड यू नो ही वॉज देर इज अ बिग कॉन्ट्रोवर्सी, बट ही इज पीपल बिलीव दैट, सम ऑफ द हिस्टोरियन डू बिलीव दैट ही वॉज अ स्पिरिचुअल मेंटर ऑफ शिवाजी, एंड ही यूज टू गाइड शिवाजी ऑन सर्टन ऑकेजन। संभाजी वॉज केप्ट देयर, एंड बट इट डिड नॉट रियली हैव मच इफेक्ट ऑन संभाजीज माइंड, एंड वन फाइन डे समहाउ संभाजी थॉट दैट प्रोबेबली शिवाजी डजन लव हिम इनफ एंड ही शुड रिबेल अगेंस्ट हिज फादर, वॉट एवर ही माइट हैव थॉट। And there was one more reason, you know, when Shivaji has led expedition into south and he came back, south India, that is Deccan, Karnataka area of Bijapur, that area was not properly administered as it was a newly conquered territory. So Shivaji thought that as there is a conflict in my house, my wife Soyrabai wants to put her son Rajaram on the throne. And Sambhaji sometimes, you know, he is indulging into certain activities which are not liked by the old nobility. But Sambhaji is nevertheless a very brave person. So I should give this southern part of my kingdom, which is newly conquered area and needs a more matured, more brave person like Sambhaji, so he can look after the administration of the southern area more effectively. And Maharashtra proper, Maharashtra, where I have started my experiment of Swaraj long back, it is having a relatively stable administrative structure and can be looked after by Rajaram with the help of with the help of his minister who are trained by Shivaji. But somehow Sambhaji feel uncomfortable. That might also be one of the reason, and he rebelled against his father. As he rebelled, he went to Mughal, and we have already discussed this. He did not like the way Dilir Khan treated the conquered people, you know, cutting the hands, torturing them, and you know, dishonoring the women. So he protested, and that led conflict between Dilir Khan and Sambhaji. Dilir Khan is having a reputation of being quite a cruel person and hated. He had a dislike and hatred for the Marathas. Even you know, during the after Purandar, he also advised Jai Singh that Shivaji is to be arrested. He is a person not to be trusted. And Jai Singh feared that probably Shivaji will be murdered, and he sends him away. We have already discussed this. So Sambhaji comes back. But you know, as because of Sambhaji joined hands with the Mughal, the arch enemy of the Marathas, he further, you know, the trust, the old nobility was not willing to trust Sambhaji, and Soyrabai, she took advantage of it, his stepmother, and he turned the people, the Nova, among the all those Ashtapradhan. We have yesterday I referred to Ashtapradhan, the eight important minister. He turned many of them towards her against Sambhaji, and you know, it's quite possible that during this phase of his life, Shivaji was quite troubled. We don't have concrete evidences what he thought about it, but probably he was quite troubled by these conspiracies that was going on in his home, and he dies in 1680. And at the time of his death, he did not very clearly nominate who is going to be his successor. Though Sambhaji was, you know, crowned as a priest during the coronation ceremony in 1674, but it is 4 years after that he revolted against his own father. And then once Sambhaji comes back to Pannala, he was kept at Pannala, but with the instruction to the Killedar, the in charge of the fort, that a strict watch should be kept on the activities of Sambhaji. So, you know, he was like, if not exactly put in the jail, but he was like a prisoner who was under the watch. Now, Shivaji dies, and Soyrabai, though he was ambitious lady, wanted to put her own son on the throne. She was not very clever. She did not have that political astuteness. So what she does is that she tries to hide this news of Shivaji's death. With the help of some of the noble, she proclaims her son as you know, as the next Chhatrapati. But she did not take the commander-in-chief in confidence, and the information, the letter was sent to the Kiledar of Pannada, where Sambhaji was almost in captivity, that a strict watch should be kept on Sambhaji. But Sambhaji somehow got the news of death of Shivaji and all that conspiracy that was going on in at Raigad, the capital. Sambhaji did had a supporter, as he was not like a prisoner put in the jail. He was just under the watch. So he gathers his people. He kills the person who opposed him, who was acting, who was taking order from Soyrabai. And then from Pannada, he with the 20,000 strong army, you know, the Senapati, the commander in chief, Hambir Rao Mohite, he joins hand with Sambhaji. He somehow trusted that as Rajaram is quite young and Soyrabai is conspiring. So, you know, there is a conflict about the person who actually fights the war and the person who conspire and into the court politics. So Soyrabai was, though she was getting the support of these people who were doing the court politics, she could not get the support of the person who actually fights the war, that is a commander-in-chief. And his support Sambhaji managed to get. As he supported Sambhaji, Sambhaji's position became very strong. So he marches out from Pannada. The people who were sent from Pannada to arrest him were arrested by Sambhaji and they were put in the jail. And Sambhaji with 20,000 strong army, he marches to Raigad, and there was nobody who could oppose him. He goes to Raigad and then he ascends the throne. He proclaims himself as Chhatrapati. Rajaram and Soyrabai, they were put in the jail. It was not a torturous jail. In fact, it is stated that Sambhaji took reasonably good care of his younger brother Rajaram. So this was the first phase. So, you know, Sambhaji, this I already over. Moropant and other who supported Soyrabai and Rajaram cause, they were arrested. And Sambhaji's crown, this is over. Well, now, you know, this was the first conspiracy, and in this conspiracy, which was an unsuccessful conspiracy, Sambhaji comes out as successful. He put Soyrabai in the confinement, but he did not give very heavy punishment to the people. But few years after that, there was another conspiracy. There was an attempt to poison Sambhaji. And when Sambhaji has had his doubt that the food that has came to me is probably poison, he fed it to the dog and he fed it to the servant. And they both of them died next day. And this angered Sambhaji. You know, he was already given to the bouts of anger. He was a bit short-tempered person. And after this second conspiracy, he inflicted very heavy punishment on the people whoever he found to have, whoever he suspected to be involved. And some of the nobility of Shivaji were killed by Sambhaji very mercilessly. They had them trampled under the feet of elephant. And it is also stated that Soyrabai, who was already under the watch, was put in the prison and then she dies. And there is a suspicion that Sambhaji poisoned her. So, you know, Soyrabai dies, and this has turned people, some people against Sambhaji. Soyrabai was daughter of Shirke. Shirke were one of the important Maratha noble, and these Shirkes, they turn against Sambhaji. And as you know, the killing of the Brahmin was considered as the heinous crime, and some of the old nobility that were mercilessly killed by Sambhaji by trampling under the feet of elephant were Brahmins. And this has also created, you know, spoiled his image, and some more people turn against him. And as a result, what happened is he became more and more dependent on a person called Kavi Kalash. Kavi Kalash was a poet, and he was North Indian Brahmin, and he came to the southern part of India. He came to Maharashtra. And because of his sweet tongue and because of his poetry, because of his learning, he somehow earned the trust of Sambhaji. But as he was outsider for the Maharashtrian people, a North Indian Hindi speaking person, he was not liked and trusted by the Maratha nobility. But as this Maratha nobility has proved to be conspiring against Sambhaji, Sambhaji now turned more and more towards Kavi Kalash, and he depended more and more on Kavi Kalash. And he created a new post called Chando Gomatya. And that apart from this eight ministerial post that is created by Shivaji. So this post Chando Gomatya was given to this Kavi Kalash, and now Sambhaji trusted only him. And this has further alienated him from the nobility, as these people did not like Kavi Kalash, and there is also belief that Kavi Kalash was a person who is deliberately spoiling Sambhaji. He is giving him intoxicating drinks, so on and so forth. Well, So this was a bit of background which I wanted to tell you, with which Sambhaji has started his rule. And now we'll turn to the topic, that is the war between Sambhaji and Mughals. So, you know, this war actually, it's under the Sambhaji, it's, though it started in 1681, the war, it was already on. Shivaji was already fighting against Mughal, and Sambhaji continued with that legacy. And we find that this, you know, according to Sir Desai, this first 3 year, Sambhaji was quite active. He was having control over a lot of areas, and he took adequate precaution of his safety. But after 84, he became a bit slack. So, you know, the war, let us now, I'm going to tell you now what were the important episodes between the war between Sambhaji and the Mughal. So after the you know very important event that has happened immediately after Sambhaji became ruler in 1681, that is the loot of Burhanpur. Burhanpur was considered as the capital of the Deccan province of the Mughal. Aurangabad was an important city in Maharashtra, but it was a Burhanpur which was a very important station. It was a kind of window to the southern part of India for the Mughal. And this Burhanpur city, which was a Mughal city, was looted by Marathas for 3 days. You know, as the Mughal army was sent to chase the Marathas, the battles were fought between the Marathas and the Mughals at different places, Aurangabad, Ahmednagar, and Solapur. And none of the battle was quite decisive because the Marathas, they resorted to guerrilla warfare. And you know, and now what happened is one thing has very important effect on this relationship between Mughal and Sambhaji. Now, Aurangzeb had a son named Akbar, and like, you know, somehow these two princes, Akbar and Sambhaji, they had certain resemblance. You know, as Sambhaji's mother has died when Sambhaji was only 2 years old, similarly, Akbar's mother have also died when Akbar was very young, and he was brought up very fondly by his father, Aurangzeb. Aurangzeb had a very soft corner for his son, Akbar. And, you know, Aurangzeb was now fighting war against the Rajput, because Aurangzeb's policies against the Hindus has turned the Rajput against him. The Rajputs, who were the supporter of the Mughal for, you know, centuries together, for generation after generation. We know the Mirza Raja Jai Singh, who was Rajput king of Amber. He was a person who put Shivaji on the back foot on the behalf of Aurangzeb. So, you know, Rajput have served the Mughal very loyally. But Aurangzeb somehow was a person who was behind his time. He wanted to turn this India into Darul Islam, to convert the people to Islam. And he sincerely believed that Islam is the only true religion, and the other religion are, you know, not a religion at all. They are blasphemy. And so we find that attitude affecting his policy. There had been a certain occasion when he had been kind to Hindus, like, you know, giving up grant and all. But by and large, this attitude of discrimination against the Hindus, it has influenced his policy nevertheless. Do you remember Jaswant Singh? Jaswant Singh Rathod was a person who had fought against Shivaji. He came to, you know, Maharashtra, and during that Agra visit, it was Shivaji who was standing behind Jaswant Singh Rathod, and this made Shivaji angry. So the Jaswant Singh Rathod, somehow he was one way or another having some connection with the Maratha state. Now the Jaswant Singh Rathod, one of the important noble Rajput noble in the Mughal hierarchy, was sent in the northwestern area to fight against the rebellion. So as the rebellion was going on there, unfortunately Jaswant Singh dies there. And Jaswant Singh had his family, his wives with him. So at the time of his death, one of his wife was, you know, she was in a family way, expectant mother. So she was brought back to Agra, and Aurangzeb kept her in confinement and sent his army to occupy the Jodhpur state. And this has angered Rajput. Rajputs, Rathod Rajputs, the follower of Jaswant Singh Rathod, they stated that our king have died serving the emperor, and the emperor is keeping our queen in confinement and sending his army for the occupation of Marwar. And during that confinement, she gave birth to a son. A child was born to that lady. And Aurangzeb proclaimed that this child has converted to Islam. He will be brought up as a Muslim, and the Jodhpur kingdom ceased to have existed. So this has further angered Rajputs, and there was a brave leader of Rajput called Durgadas Rathod. And with the brave Rajput contingent, suddenly in the night, he attacks Agra, rescues the queen and the child, and they go to Rajasthan, they go to Marwad, and the chasing Mughal army was very gallantly defeated by Durgadas Rathod. Durgadas Rathod is a very famous name among the Rajput, and you know, still there is a saying, there is a blessing in the among the Rajput community. Whenever a lady touches somebody's feet, you know, touching the feet is a tradition among the Hindus. Whenever a Rajput lady touches the feet of elder, the blessing is given that may you have a son like Durgadas Rathod. You know, so his loyalty and his selfless service to the king. So you know that small child who was carried by this Rajputs, he later on grows up as Ajit Singh, and later on becomes the king of the Rathod. So you know. Now, as all this thing was having, and this has angered not only Rathod Rajput, other Rajput ruler like Sisodia of Mewad, they also join hands with the Rajput. And Aurangzeb, as imperialistic he was, he sent his huge army to against this Rajput king, and the army was led by Prince Akbar. A very trusted child of Aurangzeb. But you know, Akbar, he goes, and before the war he has certain meeting with Durgadas Rathod and all, and Durgadas Rathod says, see, our generation after generation we have very loyally served the Mughal emperor, and we will continue to do so, but you are attacking our honor, you are trying to convert our prince to Islam, you are sending army to occupy our territory, which is not fair, and you are pushing us to rebellion. And if you are pushing us to rebellion, attacking our honor, remember that all the Rajputs will fight till the last drop of the blood remains in their body. And somehow Akbar was convinced about this. Akbar felt that his father's policy towards Rajput is not a right policy, and then he communicates with Aurangzeb that you should not fighting war against these people who had been loyal to you for generation together. Let us have a kind of compromise, let us have a meeting. And in return, Aurangzeb scolds him very badly. He says that you are afraid to fight, and things of that sort. And now the Rajputs, they understood that probably Akbar is understanding, having a soft corner, but Aurangzeb is not willing to listen. So they tell Akbar that as you know, your father Aurangzeb have dismissed his father Shahjahan from the throne. You know, Shahjahan has to remain in the prison of his own son for 12 years, and as he removed his own father from the throne and became an emperor, and Aurangzeb is turning Rajput against the Mughal, it's better you become the emperor, we will support you with the army, and you remove your father from the throne and you become an emperor. So Akbar agrees to this, and there was war. Akbar on the one side, supported by the Rajput, and Aurangzeb's position now, who was at Ajmer now, becomes very bad, because he is gone away from his capital. There is a significant number of the army which was supporting Akbar. Rajputs who have gathered there, you know, they were supporting Akbar, and he was very close to the Rajput's territory. And now Akbar plays a trick. So, you know, there was a chance that both the camps, you know, the camp of Akbar and Rajput on the one side and Aurangzeb's camp on the other side, there was a possibility that next day the war will break out and the Aurangzeb is likely to be defeated and captured. And Aurangzeb plays a trick here. You know, what he does is that he writes letter, false letters on the name of his son. And in that letter, he writes that, oh, my beloved son Akbar, you have done a very good thing by bringing Rajputs in the clutches of death. Now, next day you attack from the one side and I will attack from the other side, and the Rajputs will be annihilated. Now, this is a letters that he write, and he ensures through his spies that these letters are you know, thrown around the camps of Rajputs. And when the Rajputs got this letter, they instead of consulting Akbar, they thought that probably it is a conspiracy on the part of Akbar. So they attack Akbar's camp. Akbar's camp is looted, and then they run away. They go away from the battlefield. So next day, when Akbar sees that everything has been lost, he is at a loss what is to be done. But then he have a meeting with Durgadas Rathore, and Durgadas Rathore carries him to safety. So that is the way Aurangzeb have. Managed to defeat this joint alliance of Rajput and Akbar against him. But now the war has been lost from the side of Akbar. Now it is very difficult to gather such a huge army once again, and by the time Aurangzeb has strengthened his position. Now where the Akbar is to be kept, because now the Rajputs are once again scattered. And there is an immediate threat of invasion. So Akbar on his part and Durgadas Rathore, they thought that the person who can probably give shelter as well as to give support to Akbar, and there is an always also a possibility of becoming him an emperor of Hindustan, emperor of India, and that person is none other than new Chhatrapati, that is Chhatrapati Sambhaji. Shivaji was having a very grand reputation among the Rajput now by this time. Shivaji, who had successfully withstood the onslaught of the Mughal, and probably his son will also prove to be as capable as Shivaji, and with the help of Sambhaji, with the help of Rajput, I will capture the throne of Delhi, defeat my own father Aurangzeb. And that was a dream that Akbar has carried in his mind. And with that dream, he communicated with Sambhaji, and he, with very few trusted Rajput soldiers, with accompanied by Durgadas Rathore, he comes to south. He crosses Narmada. Say he sends. There are certain correspondence between Sambhaji and Akbar. And Akbar reaches very. He crosses Narmada and then reaches very close to Raigad. And he is now kept at a place called Pali. Pali is the name of the village where Prince Akbar was stationed. Arrangement was made for his stay. But this has angered Aurangzeb now. His own son is rebelling against him, taking help of Rajput, now taking going to Marathas and trying to take help of Sambhaji. So he settled the matter in the northern India, settled whatever dispute he had in on the northwest frontier province, kept quite a strong capable person like Amir Khan in the northwest frontier. And with his huge army, along with his sons and grandsons, he now starts marching towards south in order to capture Akbar, who dared to revolt against him, as well as to punish Sambhaji, who dared to give him shelter and planning to support him in his bid to become an emperor. And it is stated that that huge army altogether was almost numbering to 10 lakh people, 5 lakh infantry and 5 lakh cavalry. So you can understand now what kind of danger is threatening to the Maratha kingdom, which was, though Shivaji has put administration quite on the sound footing, but now it needed a very capable leader. And though Sambhaji was brave, somehow his actions have proved that he was not a right match for the situation. He could not take advantage of the very important opportunity that came into in his hand, that is about Prince Akbar itself. Up to here, is it clear to you the background? I told you about Sambhaji's problem, how he was mistrusted by the old nobility, how there was a conspiracy, how he killed the conspirator, and that turned certain Maratha nobility, including Shirkes, against him. His killing of Brahmin was also being not looked. People feel horror of killing of the Brahmin by trampling under the feet of the elephant. And Soyrabai was probably poisoned by Sambhaji, so Shirke turned against him. And what were the differences between Prince Akbar and Aurangzeb? Akbar's alliance with Rajput, and then later on his crossing Narmada and coming to Maharashtra, and Aurangzeb now chasing him with a huge army of 10 lakh soldiers. Up to here, is it clear to you? Tell me. Any doubt you have, any question?
No, sir.
Fine,
Sir,
okay.
I have one question.
Yes, Alia, tell me.
Sir, is Aurangzeb's son Akbar, he is the one who is popularly known as Akbar the Second?
I miss it somehow. Are you asking, is he popularly known as Akbar the Great?
अकबर सेकंड.
अकबर सेकंड।
यस सर, लाइक इन द ग्रेजुएशन ऑल्सो वी हैड समथिंग अकबर द सेकंड रिलेशनशिप विद द मराठास. तो
हाँ यस यस
इज ही द सेम पर्सन?
यस ही इज द सेम पर्सन हु इज सम ऑफ समटाइम्स द हिस्टोरियन कॉल हिम एज अकबर सेकंड। राइट, यू आर वेरी राइट।
ओके ओके सर, थैंक यू.
ओके, एनीथिंग एल्स? वेल ओके, वी गो अहेड नाउ। नाउ यू नो Aurangzeb was a very clever, very experienced general. He fought a number of war and he wanted to surround Sambhaji in all the directions. So as he started from his capital against Sambhaji, he wrote letters to the different powers in the southern India, like Siddhis to Portuguese, to British. British were having two important areas which were close to the Maratha territory. One was Bombay and one was Surat. So Surat technically fell in Mughal territory, but Bombay was very close to Maratha territory. And you know, this power, they always had a kind of relationship with the supreme power, that is Mughal emperor, the European power. They used to take permission from them for trading in their territory. And Aurangzeb also wrote later to Adil Shah and Qutub Shah to support his campaign against Sambhaji. And he reached to Burhanpur and then to Aurangabad, and Hasan Ali, one of the important noble, Mughal noble, with 14,000 cavalry was sent to conquer North Konkan territory from Sambhaji. And at the same time, when all this thing was happening, Sambhaji was engaged in fight with Siddhi. You know, Siddhi, Sambhaji's relationship with Siddhi we'll be discussing later on. But all these things are intertwined because, you know, as Aurangzeb has sent a letter to Siddhi to attack Sambhaji's territory, Siddhi was, you know, now as he got support of the Mughal emperor, he comes out from his hiding. You know, that Zanjira fort is very close to the western coast, very close to the Konkan area, which was captured by Shivaji. And that is the reason they came in conflict. Shivaji also had war with Siddhi, but Shivaji could not conquer Zanjira, neither Sambhaji could. But we'll be talking about his relationship with Siddhi separately. Here, I just want to tell you that Sambhaji was also engaged in war with Siddhi. You know, as Siddhi has attacked Maratha territory, captured certain people, killed certain people, so Sambhaji attacked his stronghold. And as he was pressing very hard against Siddhi, the Mughal army, they descended into the Konkan. And Sambhaji was left with no option but to withdraw from that. You know, otherwise there was a possibility that he will be sandwiched between the two armies, Siddhi's forces on the sea and Mughal forces coming from the other side. So you know, then Hasan Ali, as he descended with a strong army, he defeats Maratha at number of places in Konkan. There had been a number of war, and he captures Kalyan and he destroys certain villages in 1682. And Sambhaji was forced to come back to Raigarh, and but he took adequate precaution to protect himself. And later on, you know, the war, it continued. Later on, Kalyan was again recaptured by Marathas. Just a minute. Well, Sambhaji. Well, okay. Now, you know, this slide somehow skipped. Well, okay, fine. Most of the thing I have already told you, Akbar's coming and all. Now, you know, Akbar, as all this war was going on between Mughal and Sambhaji, Akbar continued to remain in Sambhaji's territory at a place called Pali. And Akbar continued to praise Sambhaji that let us march against the main camp of Mughal and attack Aurangzeb. But Sambhaji was not willing to take that risk because in comparison to the Mughal army, the Maratha army was numerically smaller. And then another suggestion that the prince Akbar was repeatedly giving is that let us march through Konkan and Gujarat towards north and attack the heart of the Mughal empire, that is Agra and Delhi. And on the way, we will be supported by Rajput. But you know, Sambhaji was though they were thinking about that plan, probably Sambhaji was felt that that plan is too ambitious to put into practice. Because if you go in the north and if you are defeated, probably you will lose your army, and at the same time Maharashtra will also go from your hand because there is a huge Mughal army which is stationed in Maharashtra. And second thing is that you know, Akbar's intention was to become an emperor, and in that plan he wanted support of Sambhaji. But Sambhaji from his part thought that I should support Sambhaji only, I should support Akbar only when it helps me. How can I risk my own kingdom by fighting for Akbar? And through that negotiation and disagreement, number of years were wasted. Historians blame Sambhaji that Sambhaji could not make an adequate use of Prince Akbar that came into his hand, which is partially true. But then Sambhaji was having his own problem. He was also, you know, there was also conspiracies, which I have already told you, number of conspiracies against Sambhaji. And then there was a communication problem also. Sambhaji could not communicate in the language that Akbar could understand. And you know, Akbar was also having a bit, you know, the prince-like haughtiness was there in his behavior, as it was there in Sambhaji's behavior. Whatever is a necklace was gifted by Sambhaji to Akbar, and Akbar gave this necklace to his concubine. And this was not liked by Sambhaji. And when Sambhaji asked, "Why did you give that necklace which I have sent to you to the concubine?" And Akbar replied that, "I am a prince and I can do whatever I feel like." And you know, this has created a kind of rupture between these two. Second thing, what happened is that it was, you know, Netaji Palkar who was earlier in the service of Maratha under Shivaji and then Mughal. And then comes back. So, you know, Netaji Palkar was also kept with Prince Akbar for a few days. And then it was Kavi Kalash who could, you know, communicate in Hindi with Akbar in Hindustani. But as Sambhaji was, Sambhaji was not willing to trust anybody now, as he faced one after another conspiracy. Even he suspected that probably Kavi Kalash is also conspiring against him with the help of Akbar. So, and he also had his doubt that who knows, Akbar might be a spy of Aurangzeb himself. It is quite possible that Aurangzeb, this might be a plan of Aurangzeb to destroy the Maratha kingdom from within. But you know, nevertheless, when that second conspiracy was hatched against Sambhaji to poison him, and there were certain conspirators, there were certain people who wanted Akbar to join that conspiracy, but Akbar very promptly informed this to Sambhaji that there is a conspiracy on your life. So you know, he remained faithful, but somehow Sambhaji could not have that astuteness, that cleverness of his father, that he could make an effective use of Sambhaji, effective use of Akbar. And the Akbar then finally he felt quite frustrated. He stayed there in that, you know, he was a prince brought up in luxury, and arrangement was made for him in a small village. The house was not very comfortable, and neither Sambhaji was doing anything. So he gradually started feeling very frustrated. And then he goes to Portuguese and says that he, okay, please arrange a vessel, arrange a ship for me so that I can go to Iran. He was communicating with the Shah of Iran, but that vessel also turned out to be not so good. But finally, you know, and Sambhaji, and as Sambhaji and Akbar has developed certain differences, Sambhaji also sends letter to Portuguese that Akbar is not to be given shelter. So, you know, the differences develop between these two princes. And finally, this frustrated prince, he leaves for Iran in 1687. He buys a small fleet. And at the same time, he was very hard pressed. There were attack of Mughal princes. His own brother was attacking him with the Mughal army. Siddhi was having a very strict instruction from Aurangzeb's side that if you see that Akbar is sailing through the sea, you know, Aurangzeb was getting all the information about the activities of Akbar through his spies. So Siddhi had a very strict instruction that if he sees Akbar fleeing through the sea route, he should be captured and handed over to the Mughal. So all these things have frustrated him as he saw that there is nothing, no prospectus for him to live with Sambhaji. He leaves for Iran in 1687. He reaches Iran But then he dies in 1704 before the death of Aurangzeb. And then, from there, he continued to write some of the letters to Aurangzeb. And meanwhile, Aurangzeb, through his nobility, he tried to keep communication with his son. And Aurangzeb's daughter, that is Akbar's sister, she tried to communicate with her brother, so that you come back. Aurangzeb even promised that I'll forgive all your actions, whatever you have done so far. But Akbar never trusted his father. He knew that once if he goes to his father, probably his father will put him in the jail and where he had to spend rest of his life. Even from Iran, when he has written later, and Aurangzeb stated that I have become quite old, you better come back and look after the empire now. And Akbar very cleverly writes to his own father that if you are no longer interested in ruling the empire, it is better you start your journey towards Kaaba, Makkah and Medina. After that only I'll come back to India. But this unfortunate prince dies in 1704. But that Akbar's episode he forms a very important episode in the relationship between Shivaji and sorry, Sambhaji and Mughal. And there are now a number of war, like the first war. The first important conflict I told you with Hasan Ali, who attacked Sambhaji when Sambhaji was engaged in fight with Siddhi, and Sambhaji has to retreat back. He has to come back to Pannada, and then Kalyan was captured by Mughal. So now this is another important episode, the siege of Ramsej, where Aurangzeb fails. But we'll be discussing that in the next class. So far today we have studied about the early phase of Sambhaji's life. His interaction with the Mughal, his rebellion against his father, and that is the reason many of the old nobility did turn against him. Then we discuss about the conspiracy of Soyrabai, who wanted to put her son Rajaram on the throne, and that was unsuccessful. But then second conspiracy has angered Sambhaji, and Sambhaji gave a heavy punishment to some of the nobility, but that has turned some of the nobility against Sambhaji again. At the same time, Akbar comes to Sambhaji, and chasing Akbar, Aurangzeb comes into south, and Sambhaji has to fight war on the different front, fighting against Siddhi, then Mughal, and Portuguese. His conflict with Portuguese we will be discussing later on. But though Akbar stayed in Maharashtra for almost 6 years, Sambhaji could not really very effectively mustered up the enough joint front against the Mughal. But on the other hand, Aurangzeb had proved more than a match for these two princes. He used to get all the information, continued to send army, and finally this frustrated prince Akbar, he leaves for Iran, and there this unlucky prince dies in 1704. And meanwhile, the conflict, it continues. G.S. Sardesai says that the phase of Sambhaji's life and his conflict with Mughal, it's very difficult to get a very proper, reliable information, because that was a period when Maharashtra was deeply troubled by the war. The war was fought, and who really have a time during the time of the war to sit down and keep an account of what was happening? But nevertheless, whatever idea we could get, we are trying to figure out what was really happening. And we'll be discussing some more important conflicts between Mughal and Sambhaji. I'm stopping here for today. Is there any doubt so far you are having?